First of all, thank you very much for that very generous introduction. I'm really delighted to be able to address such an interdisciplinary audience and would like to express my thanks to Professor Elliott as well as the Hawke Research Institute for providing me with this marvelous platform to share ideas on plural diversities and the politics of migrant encounter. I thought what I'll do is to be fairly brief on migration and diversities to introduce the topic. Just to say that I'll be focusing largely on sort of global city settings. Then I would like to spend a little bit of time looking at sort of approaches to migrant encounter and the way that academics from different disciplines have worked with issues of migrant encounter before turning to what I really want to focus on today, which is Singapore as a post-colonial city and the kinds of migrant encounters that animates life in Singapore. So let me start then very briefly with a few words on migration and diversity. We all know that the contemporary city is a city of what's been called anticipated as well as unanticipated encounters. And I really like this phrase, Bar's phrase, that it is a place, the very place of our meeting with the other. This conjoined phenomenon of immigration and ethnicity is constitutive not only of globalization, but of course reconfigures the kinds of spaces and social relations in cities in all kinds of ways. And in the literature, there's no shortage of shorthand sort of descriptions to describe the global city of encounters, includes like Sandercock's Cosmopolis, Mongrel City, Amin and Graham's Multiplex City, and the term that I'll be using in this particular lecture, diversity, that comes from various people, including Steve Vertovec. So there is very large and growing literature that explores the social and cultural context and texture of globalizing cities, and looking at cities as animated by a whole range of different kinds of context zones shaped by local migrant encounters. So just to remind people how Mary Pratt has defined context zones, these are places where disparate cultures meet, clash, grapple with each other, often in highly asymmetrical kind of relations of power. These encounters will pivot around a number of registers, ethnicity, race will be the usual suspects, but also, of course, nationality, class, age, sexuality, and gender. Just to remind ourselves again that the city is not just a container where differences encounter each other, but the city actually generates differences and assembles identities. Isnin has this to say, that the city is like a difference machine where groups are in the process of taking up positions, they orient themselves for and against each other, they invent and assemble strategies and technologies, mobilize different kinds of capital, and make claims on the different spaces of the city. So a few more quick words on migration and diversities. I just wanted to highlight a little bit the different perspectives from which the city's pivotal role in generating, assembling, mobilizing differences have been studied. Harking back to my own roots as a geographer, in the 90s, we all taught the spatial science tradition of that's in vogue in geography, where a study of difference focuses largely on residential segregation, looking at a geographical distribution as a way of reflecting the wider social structures and processes. So as a student, we did tons of these kinds of maps and mapping differences, where the percentage of people living in different places would tell us a little bit about the wider social structures and processes. Not very exciting. Then we moved on to sort of more constructivist kind of frameworks where social groups are defined and differentiated primarily in those days, primarily using usually one single attribute like race, class, sexuality, and criminality. So this kind of studies spawn a lot of work on, for example, ethnic enclaves defined largely by race. And you recognize, I'm sure, a picture like this is immediately recognizable as Chinatown in the largest Chinatown in the US, San Francisco. So I think so it has that kind of iconic kind of representation. This one, I think immediately you know that it's Koreatown. I mean, looking at these sort of inscriptions, and this is New York's Koreatown, and so on and so forth. So again, a lot of literature around migration and diversity, focusing largely on ethnic enclaves. Post-structuralist approaches have become come in play in recent years, and these would give weight to notions of difference as associated with power geometries, cultural politics, with performativity, subject formation, and context specificities. Again, there's a huge literature out there, which I won't summarize, but literature focusing on gated communities, for example, or on street protests as a way of gaining and claiming rights to the city. A recent handbook of diversity studies has been published, edited by Steve Vertevec, talks about how, in a sense, in post-structuralist approaches, notions of difference is to be seen as interrelational, as incomplete, as fluid, as destabilized. And there's a move from looking at issues from an either-or binary kind of classification to new logics of not only, but also. So that's how I think we go around defining ourselves these days. So diversity is not seen as a fixed kind of set of differences, but diversity is seen as overlapping multiplicities, in Glitschiller's words. So you could have a look at Vertevec's work if you're interested in this vein of study. But let me now move quickly to talking about the different kinds of approaches to looking at migrant encounter. And here I want to look at four different kinds of approaches before talking about Singapore. One is harking back to the 1950s contact theory, where the contact hypothesis basically says that contact is an effective prejudice reduction strategy because it lessens the feelings of anxiety and uncertainty because you gain more knowledge about others and gain a sense of familiarity with strangers, and that would generate a perception of predictability and control. So again, there are many projects around the globe dealing with this kind of approach. Let me just refer to the Diversity and Contact project at the Max Planck Institute, the DIFCOM project, where they're found, is seen in the last bullet point, the higher levels of immigration-related diversity leads to more frequent contact. And this has positive effects because diversity basically means when diversity increases, it becomes normalized, becomes part of the unspectacular in urban life, as it says, and more interaction then leads to more positive attitudes to immigration and diversity. A little simplistic, but this is one vein of studies that informs diversity studies. A second vein of work is what I call the three C's in the city: civility, conviviality, and cosmopolitanism. And again, there's growing literature here focusing on understanding how ethnically and linguistically and culturally diverse people, including migrants, rub along and live together in globalized cities. Here, the interest is in the everyday encounters in public places, and these could range from fleeting non-verbal encounters, people passing each other in the streets, to more sustained kind of engagements over longer periods of time. I'll come back to this in the course of the lecture. So the first C, civility, I mean, it refers to this low-level sociability in fleeting moments of contact and everyday acts of civility. So the question here is that whether these kinds of low-level civil acts are productive of respect for difference, and whether they can be scaled up to acceptable norms that can be more productive of meaningful intercultural exchange? Or are they simply superficial codes of behavior, which on the other hand may actually degenerate into drawing lines between people, those who behave according to certain codes of behavior and those who do not behave according to these codes of conduct in public spaces? And that's generated a series of discussions. This is not based on any research, but I was just interested in the kinds of signs that people put up on underground stations. The London Underground one, priority seats are given to if you're pregnant, if you have a child in arms, or if you are you need a walking stick, I suppose that signals elderly. But what was pointed out to me was that on Nagoya trains in Japan, more categories of people who can be given a priority seat. Not only the elderly, the pregnant, the child in arms, the either handicapped or injured. This man looks, this character looks very badly injured. I mean, or the last one is the most interesting. My students say it's to do with the brokenhearted. So what's interesting is that it may not be a visible sign. I think it means you have a heart condition or something like that. But my students all claim that if you can go on the MRT and show that you are brokenhearted, people will give you a seat. But this signals sort of different cultures that surrounds issues to do with civility. I mean, this is, of course, a rather inane example. But the big question is whether these kinds of codes of civility can be scaled up to more meaningful kind of intercultural exchange. A former colleague of mine, Junjie Ye, works with this idea of living with a familiar stranger, the familiar stranger being individuals that you meet in the city and interact with on the basis not of personal knowledge, but on the basis of categorical knowledge. And that happens all the time. So in the marketplace, say in Tanzania, where there are many Chinese traders, between the buyer and the seller, they may not be a common language. They probably won't be able to speak to each other in the same language, but they're still able to interact because of categorical knowledge. And here, the Chinese trader might be associated with or pigeonholed in the category of someone who sells inferior Chinese goods. So, and that then becomes the basis of the interaction between buyer and seller. So this creates all kinds of very ambivalent readings of social encounters. Are these fleeting moments of interaction, do they become hospitable kind of moments? Or do they create, in Chia's words, grounds for a civility of indifference? Or worse still, do they hide within them injuries of class, gender, race, and nationality? So these are large questions surrounding the idea of civility. For conviviality, I mean, again, my colleagues at the department, Tim Bunnell and company, have been working on issues to do with friendship networks as social ties. Networks basically make possible a functioning convivial society of strangers. These are tangible ways in which the larger urban unconscious can be felt, can be linked to the intimate spheres of private lives and relationships and within a larger public urban commons. And besides friendship ties, there's also the idea of creating spaces of interdependence and conviviality by creating micro-publics of everyday social contact and encounter, such as in Singapore with increasing xenophobia, some communities have put up, or at least one community has put up a sign saying, welcome, we are building an inclusive community, to signal a space that can foster meaningful social exchange and mutual support for the well-being of one another. So these would be spaces of conviviality. In terms of the last C, cosmopolitanism, I mean, existing cosmopolitanism, this shifts our thinking away from the concept of cosmopolitanism as a fixed universal ideal to looking at multiple cosmopolitanisms, not just a cosmopolitanism that's associated with the elite, but also, for example, working class cosmopolitans. Glitschler developed the idea of cosmopolitan sociability to describe the kinds of competencies and communication skills that are based on the human capacity to create social relations of inclusiveness and openness, even under conditions that may not be ideal, even under conditions which may be very structured by asymmetrical kind of power relations, racialization, gender hierarchies, and so forth. And that's her book, if you're interested. So a third strand, is to focus attention on emotions and affect. So we all know that urban encounters consist of a very large degree of affective kind of reactions. And works such as Dutzmeier and Hellbridge's work on situational stratification looks at urban interactions as a struggle for situational social position and prestige, where affect, moods, attitudes, bodily disgust, desires, and so forth play this very important mediating role in conditioning the kinds of interactions between strangers. And in their paper, they talk about mundane transgressions in public spaces, and the example they gave was a German man on bicycle knocking down a migrant woman, and what happens after that. What happens after that is that affect chains develop and propagate outwards from the bodies of these strangers as they encounter one another, provokes all kinds of reactions, modifies self and other, and then before they pull apart. And often these kinds of developments of affect chains happen in accordance to the scripts of gender, ethnicity, and other kinds of identity markers. My own example is also happens to be in Germany. I mean, I remember going to, I was rushing through an airport in Frankfurt, I believe, one day, and I sort of accidentally sort of bumped into somebody, and my coffee spilled on this German-speaking man. He was, I didn't realize it, so he tapped me on the shoulder, and he was livid, he was really angry. He was, he sort of yelled at me in German, and then, because I looked so blank, yelled at me in English, so I didn't understand the German, I understood the English, so I knew he was very angry. So, interesting, my own reaction, I mean, I knew that whatever I say will not be sufficient to calm him down, it'll be inadequate. So instead of speaking, I sort of kind of pretended that I didn't speak English. So, and then I remember how people in Japan are always so polite and good. So I started sort of assuming the posture of a Japanese woman, perhaps, and bowing, sort of like to show deference, and that calmed him down. So I mean, so I know that. I don't know why I'm relating this, but I mean, reading that paper reminded me of that incident where in public spaces you need to, in a sense, have different strategies in terms of interacting with people, especially when affective kind of issues and emotions are involved. Okay, I'm going to skip all this because I know I won't have time. So the idea here is that affect is not just individual. A collective affect basically is not reducible to the individual and a wider effect, and can turn sort of disinterested people into a bystander audience or to more active participants. Everybody was gathering around to see this performance between the Japanese woman and the German man. So, I mean, so it was important to calm things down. So these kinds of effects can transform places into either welcoming or inhospitable spheres. A fourth sort of strand of the kinds of literature on the global city I encounter has to do with migrant concentrations, reputational ghettos, and spaces of appearance. Here, I like my teacher, Carrie Peach's term best. He talks about how, in a sense, prejudice and discrimination of migrant neighborhoods can solidify them into what he calls reputational ghettos. So you don't even have to be a ghetto by a technical ghetto. If you have the reputation of a ghetto, then you are a ghetto. So, and of course, moral panics are triggered off by these kinds of reputational ghettos as a result of the hypervisibility of migrant presence. And this could lead to increased sort of legal control as well as police repression on account of urban security and hygiene solutions. So you see the picture on the left. On the far left there, sort of auxiliary police policing Little India in Singapore. But what's interesting is that these kinds of social spatial stigmatization may legitimize and solidify alternative kind of identities and become a vehicle for demanding and securing political and economic gains. This is what Arian calls spaces of appearance, where people might get together in a show of common visibility, occupying some sort of important sort of symbolic spaces in order to create this emergent, unexpected sense of belonging and solidarity across different groups in order to generate power and potential for collective action, as was seen in the Gezi resistance across different alliance of different groups in Gezi Park in 2013. Okay, that was supposed to be the prelude. Now I'm going to try to apply some of these ideas to Singapore to look at migrant encounters in post-colonial city of Singapore. And here, just a short introduction in case those are not familiar with Singapore. Singapore is often called the demographic child of colonial diaspora because from birth, it already embodies many of the tensions of blood and belonging that the concept diaspora evokes. So essentially, from day one, Singapore already contains sort of many pieces of overlapping diasporas. So this is a picture or a model of a notebook key in Singapore that was presented at the Colonial Indian Exhibition in the 1880s, showing, of course, a polyglot population, a whole cast of different kinds of characters from China, from India, from the Malay archipelago, all in a sense ending up on the shores of Singapore. So that was Singapore in the colonial days. After independence, there was a period of nation building where migration was not as high, but in the last three decades, there are new streams of transnational migration, and these new sorts of mobilities and migrations have fractured previous patterns on the ground and introduced new sources of diversity. So even before Steve Atavak used the term, some cartoonists in Singapore had already used the term diversity Singapore. So, okay, so and just one piece of statistics in the whole lecture, Singapore has a population of about 5.5 by now. So in 2013, it was 5.4. And if you look at it, 61% citizens constitute only 61% of the city, the city-state. The other 39% are non-citizens, foreigners, either non-residents or permanent residents. So this is a city with a very high percentage of non-citizens in its midst. Okay, so let me now go on to what are applying some of the ideas that I've spoken about to Singapore. There are three sections to this particular part of the talk. The first, I'd like to look at plural diversities and unanticipated kind of encounters. So again, just a little bit of background. In the immediate kind of post-colonial nation building phase, against this backdrop of a plural society with racialized categories that's been hardened by colonial policy, the new national leaders of Singapore decided to try to weld together the different groups on the basis of an ideology of what's been called separate but equal multiracialism. This idea that we can be many races, separate races, but equal in this in the multiracial complexion. So four official races were designated, CMIO, Chinese, Malays, Indians, and others. So this is often known as CMIO, multiracialism. And these groups are supposed, as I said, to be separate but equal to encourage the coexistence of different religious practices, customs, and traditions without prejudice and discrimination for any one particular community. So this is, of course, the philosophy. So in Singapore, CMIO features in everyday life, including language. So saya awak kita in Malay, wo ni woman in Chinese. Sorry, I don't speak Tamil, so a failure of multiracialism as far as I'm concerned, but that's supposed to represent the Indians, and of course, English being the neutral language, I-U-V. But this space of encounter is now more complex because it's not just the older settled once migrant population that we need to take into account, but there are newer streams of current migrants, and in the interactions between the older and current migrants, we see all forms of contradictions of sameness and difference occurring simultaneously. And to illustrate that, let me just give a couple examples. One is that Singapore sits in this very paradoxical space of being predominantly Chinese, we are over 70% Chinese, but also anti-Chinese. As evident in the mounting social tensions in recent years, to do largely with the contemporary flows of migrants from China. So in 2013, we had what's called the White Paper protests, which is essentially an anti-immigrant protest against largely Chinese migrants. This poster saying Singapore for Singaporeans. So Singaporeans are beginning to dissociate themselves from their ethnicity and to identify more with their nationality. And in that space, PRC Chinese are seen very much as the other. And when China gave us two pandas for the river safari as part of panda diplomacy, you hear sort of the orangutans, the native orangutans whispering foreign talent, you know. So this is in a sense an illustration of the politics of envy and, you know, that bubbles beneath the surface. So, and the example that illustrates this best is when an immigrant Chinese family complained about the smell from curry cooked by their Singaporean ethnic Indian neighbors. So one thing you don't do in Singapore is don't complain about the food. Okay, that's disastrous. But this immigrant Chinese family was not keen on the smell coming from the curry cooked by their Indian neighbors. And that led to a retaliation on the part of the citizens, calling on all fellow Singaporeans of all races to deliberately cook Indian, Malay, Eurasian, Chinese varieties of curry en masse on a designated weekend as a show of solidarity with the Indian family and as a form of anti-immigration protest. Right? So, and this basically has now been made into a play. So cook a pot of curry, it lives on a national day. So every national day now, there is a multicultural curry parties organized because we want to see curry as a positive thing that unites people, not offend people. So you see the politics of curry sort of being stirred into these kinds of equation. So the point here is that the complicated politics and paradox of distance and proximity in dividing and uniting some but not others are particularly salient in this kind of post-colonial context, which is very different from, say, in Western contexts where there is a clear white majority and where the cultural self-other divide is more consistently aligned with majority-minority identifications. In Singapore, in many post-colonial situations, it's far too messy to see any kind of lines that can be clearly defined between self and other or between majority and minority. And it is these kinds of strongly racialized contours of post-colonial Singapore where we see race diversities pluralized, leading to unanticipated kind of encounters that do not necessarily resonate with the expected racial categories. Okay, a second prong of what I want to talk about has to do with what happens in these transient spaces of appearance. In Singapore, migrant subjects are differentially incorporated into the nation state along fairly bifurcated lines. If you're a talent migrant, that means you're highly skilled, you're professional, you are incentivized to take up permanent residency and citizenship and to lay down roots. If you're a labor migrant, particularly if you're unskilled or performing 3D jobs, then you are locked away in this use and discard regime that enforces transience. So maintaining this very strict categorical control between temporary non-residents and permanent residents creates all kinds of problems for the space of encounter. So you see here, illustrated in the Straits Times, sort of the foreign professional given a first-class welcome, but the foreign construction workers would not be treated in the same way. So for the vast majority of lowly paid migrant workers who are admitted into the city-state as transient or disposable labour, pathways to residency or citizenship are strictly not available, and this creates this very palpable sense of temporariness where people are constantly adjusting to transnational lives whilst inhabiting cities, which in Triff's words are leaking away into a space of flows. So this contradiction between a large migrant population that's supposed to be transient, they're supposed not to be there, they're supposed to disappear in time. The contradiction between the transience that's expected and the palpable visibility of these migrant concentrations have raised all kinds of social anxieties and created sorts of panics about the need to tighten control and surveillance or to keep these kinds of populations out of sight. So there are three modes of the cultural politics of urban encounter that I want to talk about, but because time is short, I'm going to skip the first and skip the second, which is to do with control and containment. These what we call weekend enclaves, foreign worker gatherings, are often viewed very negatively, and authorities have been asked to relocate them to out-of-sight locations such as offshore islands. Imagine that. So, and then residents would put up sort of barricades around their flats to try to keep the foreign workers out. You see sort of signage like these that are not found in other parts of Singapore, but in Little India, saying no sleeping, no eating, no littering, and no urinating. No littering is, I think, common in Singapore, but no urinating is something that's quite unusual. And the deployment of auxiliary police to control places like Little India. So things got worse in December 2013 when Singapore had its first riot in 40 years, I think, involving foreign workers. This happened when a male Indian national, a construction worker, died after being hit by a bus. And they were supposed to be ferrying the workers back to their dormitories. And the mobs basically attacked the bus, and a riot broke out, and there were all kinds of the aftermath of it I won't go into in terms of the debates and so forth, but Little India then became a space of exception. Alcohol sales were banned in Little India, there was increase in police surveillance and in Little India, but outside Little India we also saw an increase in what I've called spaces of enclosure. Mega dormitories and facilities to try to reduce the need for foreign workers to go down to Little India and create spaces of appearance. So in that sense, we see here the re-emergence of perhaps enclave societies that's not dissimilar to colonial enclaves. So one of the strategies of containment has to do with this creation of these mega dormitories. You see in very far out places like Tuas in Singapore. This one is accommodates 16,800 beds. It has a mini mart, a beer garden, a food court, cinema, cricket field, etc., etc., essentially designed to keep workers happy, but to keep them within the compound. Third and last sort of set of issues I want to discuss under this theme has to do with care and cosmopolitan hope. Alongside the enclosure and alongside the containment, there are also sort of increasing concern for migrant workers. And this has been, I would say, one of the leading edges in progressive development within civil society landscape in Singapore. So what happened was that there was growing dismay over the treatment, particularly of domestic workers in Singapore, and concern that there's inadequate sort of state action and public apathy, given the increasing incidences of maid abuse in recent years. So there's been a broad range of NGOs that have emerged, focusing largely on migrant workers, providing services, shelter, skills training, as well as a small number of advocacy-oriented groups. So these are some of the soup kitchens and all that that I normally bring my students down to in Little India. I've got 5 minutes to do one last last part of what I want to talk about today, which is to focus not so much at the public sphere, but to move our discussion into the home spaces to look at intimate encounters of in home spaces in this of the city. So my sense is that beyond the public sphere, it's also important to locate spaces of encounter in the sphere of the intimate within families, households, homes, etc. And there is a lot of merit in considering scale issues, starting with the body and spanning outwards to the global or closing in from the global to the body. So to me, it's important to also focus not just on public space, but also the intimate spaces of the home. And different academics have done work of relevance, like Nava's idea of domestic cosmopolitanism, where cosmopolitanism emerges from engagement in otherness, not in the public sphere, but within the privacy of the home. Michael Douglas talks about the idea of global householding, where because of the care deficit within many homes, many households now rely on both market and non-market based options predicated on the international movement of people. So importing foreign domestic workers into the home to take care of the elder care or childcare work, for example. Or the other version of foreign domestic workers would be foreign brides being imported into working class homes, also sometimes to fulfill exactly the same functions of providing care for the elderly and for children. So this more holistic understanding of living with difference in cities needs to take into account the way intimate labor is performed in home spaces, and this will reflect and reinforce the larger sociabilities and structural inequalities of the city. So in the context of elder care, Ochai talks about liberal familialism, where the cost of purchasing care labor is borne by the family, but where filial piety can now be outsourced to others whose services are bought from the market. So you see here an example of that, a foreign domestic worker watching television drama, probably Korean drama, with her elderly Singaporean employer. Both won't understand a word of Korean, but they still enjoy the drama together. So this kind of, in a sense, to replace for the filial piety that's supposedly performed by sons and daughters. So it's a foreign domestic worker, part of the family. You see that in photographs where the foreign domestic worker is included in part of the family, but also have to remember that her family is also at the other end of the iPhone. There was a important point for us is the Anthony Chen's Ilo Ilo film won the Golden Camera Award at the Cannes Festival. This is the first Singapore film to have done so. And the theme of it is on foreign domestic workers as part of the family. Okay, and finally, apart from foreign domestic workers, in Singapore, international marriage rates have gone up considerably. Cross-nationality marriages involving a citizen spouse and a foreign spouse accounts for almost 40% of all marriages registered each year. And a large chunk of that would be working class men who find themselves not marriageable within the Singapore market, looking for wives in the region in order to find a companion. So agencies have sprung up, like this one called Best Match Marriage Consultant, and you probably can't read it here, but it says, a Vietnam wife is keen to do household chores and is willing to take care of parents wholeheartedly. So that's, yeah, okay. So I've got many things to conclude, but I'll just, in a sense, focus on one, which is the need to rethink the politics of diversity and migrant encounter across a range of more contact zones, including both public and private spaces. So as seen in hopefully what I've been talking about, these kinds of politics of diversity manifest in relationships with others in the city, where the other may be strange, may be unfamiliar, but may as well be intimate and even familial. So in that sense, a politics of diversity in the global city needs to span different kinds of otherness. Public civility, in my view, may not always be the litmus test for private prejudices and moralities. And for a global city to develop this truly cosmopolitan urban ethic, then we need to see that its streets, as well as its homes, would be places of self-knowledge and not fear. Okay, so thank you for your attention.